Good afternoon. Thank you for attending our study session. And this meeting is being recorded by Pasco City TV, channel 191 in Pasco on Charter Cable. And it will be broadcast over the next 2 weeks. The meeting will also be available online at the district's YouTube channel and the PSC TV's on-demand site at www.pasco-wa.gov. And the topic that we're going to go through tonight in our study sessions is, for the first half hour, we have a book here that we've been studying for the last 6 months or so. We started studying it a little bit before last fall's election, probably end of last summer. And this book is called Good Governance is a Choice, and it says a way to recreate your board the right way. And a lot of us here have read through quite a bit of this book already, but I thought today we'd start off for the first half hour of this study session and go through the first two chapters, talk about the highlighted points, and if we want to get into detail on how any of these points pertain to our board, we can do that. And then for the next hour, from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock, we'll continue on our board planning that we've had a couple sessions on here, with the idea that we continue to brainstorm. Hopefully we put ideas up on this board, and as we read through the first two chapters of this book, I think it'll tie in on the points that talk about governing through policy. So we'll attempt in the next hour to bring up brainstorming things that we think are priorities for the district, and if we can, we'll briefly state them in a high-level policy type sentence. So chapter one of this book says, why don't boards perform better? And there's multiple, I think five or six obstacles in here. Six, it looks like. And maybe we can each take one, go around the circle here, read the first one. Mr. Christensen can take the first one and summarize what he thinks that means. And then the rest of us can chime in if we want to talk about how that applies to our board.
Let them know the beginning of the whole thing. Why don't the boards perform better? They did all these exit interviews with retiring board members, and they asked them if they felt like they were able to make a difference. And the overwhelming response was no. And what was oftentimes said, why you can't make a difference, many times dealing with decisions that had been made long before the meeting, and the board's meetings were more public ceremonies than occasions to get work done. So those are some of the things that happen and why board members don't feel like they're making a difference. So with their research, these are some of the things that they came up with. So I think that's important to know.
So we'll talk about the six obstacles that Ms. Phillips is alluding to right here.
All right, so first one, obstacle number one, misunderstanding the board's job. And I think we are a new board in the sense that we just had a recent election. Three of us have been on the board for 2 years. Aaron is new and Sherry's been here for a while, but I think it's important that we understand what our job is, and this is one of the shortcomings of many boards. They get in the mode of just doing something without really understanding what their role is. One of the things that should suggest here, mentally reconstruct your last board meeting agenda. How many policy level decisions did you make? How many issues on the agenda were presented within the context of an existing board policy? And then what percentage of the board meeting time was devoted to policy level decisions? As a board, if we want to be a policy board, which I think would be the right direction, we need to make sure we're functioning at the proper level, not getting down into the operations part of the governing, but staying up at a high level where we can give direction, and it's critical that we understand that as a board and kind of move that direction together. Let's see. Is there anything else anybody wants to?
Some of the studying I've done, some of the conferences that I've been to, talk about a balanced board. because staying entirely in the policy makes it really hard to function. But getting down into the grassroots really isn't where a board should be. And so staying mostly in policy with some lower, that's what the one thing that I can't remember. Do you remember the guy that we went to, or Steve, that one, the first day of WASDA?
Anyway. Tom.
Yeah, Green, was it? Anyway, he talked about studying all these boards and people who were in the policy, the balance actually were the most successful. He also has a company that goes in and goes through all of our meetings, and for a relatively small fee, he can go through our last 12 meetings and tell us where we're spending most of our time, whether it's in policy, whether it's in operations, and he has found that spending 40% of the time in operations and 60% in student achievement is the ideal ratio. So it goes right along with that.
And I think something that we can continue to evolve on and improve on is, those are probably good percentages, and I know you and I have talked before about, well, how do we track student achievement? How do we tie in all the requirements we have with the Washington State Learning Standards, with the required tests that we have? And we can probably do that with some thought. We can set high-level board policies, and we don't need right now to talk about what those look like, but we could set policies that talk about what tests are required, you know, state and federally, and what we do as a board. Or another example, last week at our board meeting, we were talking about student discipline and how we're implementing that throughout the district. Well, we can talk about it until we're blue in the face, and then I, as a board member, I think I said something like, I'd like to see that implemented consistently across the district. Well, I don't want to be the one giving direction. We're a board here, so we'd all need to agree on it. But this next thing that we go into would be a tool that, if I think that's important, I could say I would like to see student discipline or bullying consistently implemented throughout the district. Throw it up there, and later on we'll talk as a board. Do we want to follow that up and write district policy on issues like that, or student achievement or testing? But I think that's where we're going to go with this brainstorming here, is that we'll, right now we're not going to shoot any ideas down, we'll put them up there, and then we as a board will determine which of them we want to follow up with on board policy as instruction to our superintendent. Dr. Richardson, would you like to talk about the next one?
So the second obstacle is kind of a variation on the first, having to do with kind of confusion of what our role is, and specifically mentions supervising the superintendent, or the CEO as it's called in the book, and kind of micromanaging the superintendent and trying to get involved in every detail of different programs, personnel and financial things and programs, or perhaps hiring committees to make recommendations, when really, if we've taken the time and hired a superintendent and entrusted them to perform that role, then they should be able to carry out those tasks with our direction being at the policy level to kind of set the standards like we've been trying to do with Ms. Whitney. Kind of set the expectations, what the vision is of our school district, with input from the community and all stakeholders, what do we want our school district to be, what's our vision, and then allowing the CEO or superintendent to kind of carry out that vision and establish the protocols and things to carry that out.
Anybody else comments on that one?
You want to do the next one, Ms. Phillips?
The next is just a lack of an effective operating system. Just basically rules that the board, well, an operating system that the board runs by, and we kind of have a written job description better than this says. So anyway, I don't know what you want to say about that.
So this one we actually did go through end of last summer as a board. Of course, like we mentioned, we have one new board member, but we went through our role as a board and our roles and responsibilities and edited that back
6 months ago or so. But Mr. Richardson may have already read through that, and if he hasn't, he can get with me offline and get him a copy of that and have him go through that as well. And if he has any suggestions for changing that, let me know. All right, Ms. Lincoln.
Number four is about the lack of clarity about the role of the CEO or the and the board, and about teamwork, about working with the superintendent and the board, and about the decisions and accountability. About the board wanting the operational part of it too. That's it's talking about.
One thing I, to add to that, one thing I picked up on this one was a highly functioning board doesn't just take the agenda from the CEO or from the superintendent and then rubber stamp it. And I don't think we do that. We've been accused of that, of course, sometimes in the past. All boards probably are accused of that. But there's always room for improvement, and I think we'll continue to improve. But I think we as a board have been doing a good job and getting better all the time at planning, setting what we think needs to be done in the district, and then turning it over to the superintendent. But like I said, we can all always improve on that. And then obstacle number five talks about failure to effectively manage the board's own performance. And this, we talked about this a couple months ago, but something that we need to implement as a board, and the last time we did it was probably a year and a half ago when we submitted the application for highly performing boards in the state at WASDA. But we need to figure out as a board how to do our own self-assessment. So there's one available through WASDA that we can do maybe as a first cut, but I know Ms. Phillips also has additional ideas and additional something that we can do there, so I'll get back with her. And
yeah, if you want to say more about it, go ahead. I'm from the same guy that talks about the importance of balanced government. With the people there, he allowed us to reprint it. Otherwise, he charges for the assessment. It goes into greater detail than the WASDA one, and I think, and he has a really short one, and then he has a longer one. I really think we need to make it a priority, because I think it'll help us know how each other works and also how other people perceive us. And that can be really valuable, because oftentimes we have no clue how we're being perceived, and we don't intend to project that. And so once we know personally, we can help with those perceptions. So there was a lot of powerful things that a self-assessment could help us with. And help us work better together.
So would we all as a board be willing to commit to doing, at least for now, the WASDA self-assessment, say by the end of February? And I can send or have Valerie send out the link to that.
Do we have an opposition? The WASDA one is about the same. This one's just a little more detailed. Do we have any opposition to sending that one out, having us do that one?
Instead? It's no cost.
It's no cost to us.
Okay, why don't you send that to me and I'll look through it, and then we'll get that out. So we'll as a board commit to completing a self-assessment before the end of February, and it'll either be the one Ms. Phillips speaks of or the WASDA one, but I have no problem going with the other one.
Then will we share that report on the first study session in March, or when?
The next study session we have, or it may be a longer board retreat. Mr. Christensen has some ideas too, but we'll either get together on a weekend or an evening or a study session and go through it at our next meeting like this.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a good idea. I'm not sure exactly what these assessments entail, but when I was in residency, we did what we called 360 evals, and essentially everyone evaluates everyone. It's not just the mentors evaluating the medical students or residents, but the nurses evaluating the doctors, and the doctors, the nurses, and the staff, and the support staff, and really getting that buy-in from everyone involved and as part of the team to really see where we're at. And sometimes it starts with a good self-eval, but it's good to know, you know, how we are perceived by others, how we're meeting expectations that others would have for us.
So this one would just be a self-evaluation, but yeah, I've done 360s also, where you get it from the bottom up, top down, and you're from your peers. We can talk about that later.
Build up to that. Yep. Start with the self-assessment.
Can I send that to maybe to you, Michelle, and you can just send out just the self-assessments, and everyone can see both the WASDA and this other one and determine which they go to do. Or do I do that to
Scott? Had asked to look through it. I don't know.
Go ahead and just send it to her.
Well, I just don't know with the. I know that we can.
I don't want to send it to all you guys, so yeah. Send it to Michelle. She can send it to each of us.
Is all of us talking about it. If I send it to you and then you send it out, then everyone will have a copy. And then if you guys want, we can decide. Okay. Can we just let you, Michelle, know like what preference we have? And if three of us want to do the one and two won't do the other, then.
Well, I think we all need to know the same one.
No. We just need to let her know what our preference is. And when we figure that out, then we can decide which one to do.
I'll trust you. I mean, if you've looked through it, I mean, we've all done the WASDA one already. If you think that this other one's better, let's just go with that. Just send it to Miss Whitney, and she'll send it out, and we'll all complete it before the end of the month. And if we want to do the WASDA one later, we can, but we'll complete.
And
the
then
one.
We'll go over the results.
We'll go over the results and discuss a path forward there.
Okay.
So on this assessment, I think we need to be careful. He said we could use it because we were in attendance at that meeting, but we need to make sure we give him credit and that we control it, that it doesn't get out of hand.
I don't think I attended that session.
Okay.
We need to know if there are certain restrictions on what we use it for, how we evaluate it, if there's any ongoing.
I think for this time, we certainly have permission to use it. I think if it's something we use again and again and again, I think we might be pushing his.
Thomas Hall's very.
Yeah, because ideally you'd use something similar over time so that you could compare and not have changing your evaluations every year. It makes it harder to.
I'm sure he would have no problem letting us use it if we compensated him. And then finally, obstacle six, lack of the long-term vision for the organization and the board. And I think this is one of the things that as a board that would be very beneficial for us. What is our long-term vision? And to get that clarified, and I think we're going to talk about that a little later here tonight, hopefully. But what do we want? How do we want our organization to perform? What are the things that we're working on? Our long-term vision for the school district, for the students, for all the stakeholders, and then for us as a board. Where do we want to be and what are we doing to get there?
So that's the first chapter. And the second chapter says, okay, here's the challenges. The first chapter talked about the challenges that boards have. And the second chapter says, what does a high-performing board look like? And on this, we'll go through them fairly quickly, try to finish up in the next 15 minutes or so. But there's 12 different traits that I call traits of high-performing boards. And we'll go through those quickly and talk about what we could do better if there are examples, and talk about what we're doing well if there are examples of that. So you want to do the first one, Dr. Richardson?
So the first one, the high-performing boards know what their job is. So, you know, a lot of these obviously are not doing they're overcoming the obstacles, they're not making the mistakes that low-performing boards make. So essentially having a good idea of what our role is, understanding that, defining that in writing, and following through with that.
High-performing boards function at the level of policy, and I think we've already discussed that.
So high-performing boards create their own governance.
Okay. The next one is high-performing boards follow the rules. So it says there's one thing to set performance standards for the boards, and sometimes it's quite another to actually comply with those rules. So once we do set policy, that is the rule. And if we can't or district employees can't comply with that policy, then it's our job to go reassess that policy and make updates to that policy so that it can be followed.
Number five, high-performing boards plan their own work, meaning as a board, we need to be setting the direction that's well, not only in our meetings, but in the district, we need to be determining what the work we want done, not, and certainly we need input from the superintendent who's there in the day-to-day works of it, but we shouldn't be just taking whatever the superintendent gives us as, and running the board based, or running our school district based on her input. We need to be planning the work and making sure that the work that we plan is gets done.
And that's my job. Mr. Christensen also comes to the planning meetings for the agenda. Ms. Phillips has been before, Ms. Lincoln's done it. But it's up to all of us. You know, if you have something that you want put on the agenda or that you think's timely, you know, send it to me and I'll work to get it on the agenda. Everyone's an equal share in the board here. We got 5 members. Ideas come from everybody. Agenda setting comes from everybody. So you don't have to necessarily attend the agenda setting meeting to get your vision onto the agenda.
Okay, number 6, high-performing boards have a long-term vision. So this is, you know, vision of our school board, like we've been talking about, assessing how we're doing and how vision we have to function as a school board and also for the school district. And they commented that sometimes we, you know, you hire a CEO with a vision for your school district possibly, and that, well, that can be a good thing. Ideally, the school district vision should encompass the community and kind of what type of school district do we want in our community, and since each community is different and has unique needs and interests, and so setting that, those visions are important.
High-performing boards focus on outcomes, and I love this one. I think it's key to what we do. I loved Ms. Whitney's ideas of really narrowing our focus in some of these things. I know a lot of the conferences that we go to, the classes focus on highly functioning and highly school districts that are really functioning at a really high level. And all of them, I think without question, had very distinct and very short sets of goals. And I think that's somewhere that encompass some of these things that can be put underneath the goals. We don't lose the focus, but I have to stop and think about what these are sometimes. And we're not, I think we can improve on focusing on outcomes. Is this working? Are our kids' scores increasing as we implement these things? Are we getting where we want to? Or not just scores, but graduation rates or kids reading at a certain level by a certain age. You know, whatever our goals are, they need to be simple. They need to be, you know, anyway. And so, and then we need to be outcome-based. And I think we need to do a better job of all of us and the whole district knowing precisely what those are. And if there's 20 of them, it's too hard to do. So I think that's kind of the direction we're going in, and I'm excited to see where it takes us.
High-performing boards understand the separation of responsibility between the board and the superintendent. And I think that's a very important thing. There's a difference between what the board does and the superintendent.
So members of high-performing boards deal consistently and fairly with each other and with the superintendent. It says boards are made up of individuals, and this is frequently where the most difficult issues arise. Some members seem to have little interest in working in a collegial manner with other members or with the superintendent. Instead, they seem to thrive on controversy when it isn't there naturally, and they tend to create it. So it just talks about dealing consistently with each other, treating everyone with respect. And I think we do that as a board, but it's just something to keep in mind that we're not here to create controversy. We're here, if there's issues, to help with the long-term vision planning and acting together as a board in the best interest of all the students.
High-performing boards operate efficiently. So I think part of that is we have an agenda. We understand what's on the agenda, whether it's in a meeting like this or in our regular business meeting. And it takes time to set that, and it needs to be goal-focused, but once we get that set, then we need to come and take care of that business and move on, be efficient.
What do you think about time? Did you notice that had time limits for each item?
Yeah, I think, though, does it say that we need to follow the, I don't think you need to stick strictly that time. I think part of it, you got to set the right amount of time. You do need a deadline. Otherwise, you could go on and on and on. But on the other hand.
As we've seen in some of our community forums.
Well, I think, though, that, yeah. I mean, it depends on the purpose of the meeting. And I think, again, you need to have a structure, but on the other hand, you can't be so tied to that structure that you're not affected. So,
yeah, there's a balance, right? I mean, like we mentioned the community forums, and you know, the first community forum, we didn't have a time limit. There were less people there, so they got a lot more time. And one community member, I think, spoke for about 15 minutes, and you know, the first 5 minutes was a long biographical sketch, and so that was probably excessive. But then the next one, we had a 3-minute time limit, I believe, Scott, and people were frustrated and fumbling that they had prepared something and it felt like 3 minutes wasn't adequate. So, you know, that type of thing may need a balance, and okay, please try to keep your comments to about 5 minutes, but not be so strict where people are not able to finish their thoughts, but kind of emphasize that we don't want people to go off for 10 or 15 minutes, but you know, make your point, and you know, we're not going to cut you off and have a timer. A
just
lot
don't
of
go over 5 minutes.
Just keep it to roughly 5 minutes.
Make it two. Set your goal for two and be done by five.
Yeah. Well, I think the hard part that the community has with that is, you know, our comments don't have limits. And, you know, in our board meetings or in our forums, we don't have limits really to our time. So,
unfortunately, there's only five.
Right. Yeah. But we have meetings, you know, every other week and, you know, twice a month. And they come to one forum and want to be able to have, not be told, oh, stop, time's up, you know, so.
Well, and I think, though, yeah. All right.
The time limits actually were talked about were actually ones that they included for our purposes, not community.
But you brought up the community forum, so that's why I just mentioned, and that's the feedback I got from the forums.
Delicate balance.
So number 11, high-performing boards never embarrass themselves or the organization. So I think as it mentions in here, the challenge is to address issues that arise in a tactful way, and certainly hiding issues or not dealing with problems is not an effective way to perform, but to be tactful, there's no sense in needing to publicly embarrass people or call people out, but we do, you know, we need to identify issues and address them and move forward.
And I'd say this one ties into what we've been dealing with. For the past 6 months, we have people come into board meetings and they want to personally attack individual members of the staff or individual board members. And what we're saying here is, you know, everyone has freedom of speech, but what this says, as board members ourselves, it says, in doing the required work of the board, it isn't necessary to level public criticism at individuals. Most open meeting laws allow anything related to the performance of an individual to be discussed legally in a closed meeting. Is our belief that the board should deal publicly and openly with organizational performance issues, but reserve any comments critical of individuals to a legally confined closed session. So this comes into the fact that that's why we as a board choose to talk about personnel decisions, and if we're going to talk critically of a staff member or evaluate a staff member, we do it in executive session, and we have that right to. So as board members, we don't condone publicly disparaging individuals or staff members, and we won't condone, you know, it's happened in board meetings, sometimes someone throws something out at the end of their conversation, but if a member of the public wants to throw that out at the start of their conversation and continue throwing it out, it's my job to remind them that we as a board don't condone individual attacks.
I think along those same lines, I mean, I know there's people that get frustrated about things, but it is destructive when you start getting critical and demeaning. I mean, you can make change effectively in a positive way. And I think we just need to be careful of that as a board and with our administrative team. Just make sure we're positive.
Yeah.
There's plenty to work on. We've all got faults. It's no fun when somebody points them out, especially publicly.
You got one more.
High performing boards.
Twelve.
Sorry.
No problem.
High performing boards are in touch with their owners. I think this is critical and something that I think sometimes is overlooked. I think it's something that we've really focused on and really improved on as a board, but that's all opinion. Board members of any organization are there because the owners themselves are not. They have entrusted the board to lead, serve, and represent their interests. In other words, the board is the owner's proxy. Most boards don't do a very good job of meeting this expectation. They purposefully plan and connect with the owners only when something is needed in return, but not usually at any other time. And like I said, I feel like we are really working as a board together to overcome that is so common across the nation, the boards.
And our increased communication, transparency, community forums, those are, I feel like we've done it in the past. I feel like we've talked to the public, but we're stepping up that effort lately in order to move past what we've dealt with in the last 6 months, and we're moving forward in a positive manner.
Yeah, I think that's been appreciated by the community. I think the community recognizes that, and our last meeting we had at New Horizons was very uplifting, and lots of students came, and even at our last board meeting where the students made comments, we have one issue maybe at the end, but the majority of the students' comments were great, and I loved hearing their comments and ideas, and I hope we get more of that even from students, teachers, parents. I mean, that's how we are able to understand, the community and what the vision should be.
And this started even before 6 months ago as we started going out. We dealt with boundaries. We've had some frustrated parents 1 year. Yep. So the next year we said, let's go out to the schools and let's deal with boundaries there. So we have really been reaching out this last while and yep. Different Facebook things and question and answers online. So lots of things that we're getting.
Okay. And then as a segue, so we're done with the first two chapters here. As a segue into our brainstorming or planning that we're going to do, I think there's a good, it's not really a diagram, but if you go to page 48, there's an example of policy level leadership here. On the bottom of that box on page 48, you can see an example of school safety. And it says what the board could do is they could set policy that says, the superintendent will permit no unsafe conditions anywhere within the organization. That's the level if we want to lead at the policy level, the level of detail that we would put into our policy. When the policy actually gets written and goes through everything that it needs to and we end up approving it, it's going to be much longer than that, right? It'll be several paragraphs. But in our brainstorming, if we can focus on simple little statements here at this time, we'll put them up there, and then we'll later as a board rank those and decide which of them, if any, we would like to pursue as making board policy. And then it comes down and it says, here's what the superintendent would do with that statement. They would say, every school site will have an approved safety plan. All schools will have monitored video cameras throughout the building. All outside entrances will be locked except for the main entrance, and armed guards will be on duty while the building is occupied. That extensive detail is what the actual schools themselves are going to implement after the CEO, after the superintendent takes the board policy and flows that down throughout the organization. So we have our old brainstorming-ish topics up here, and we'll just have an open table here, open microphone for the next hour, and we'll see what else we can come up with. The little blue goals right there on the left-hand side are goals that are in our district strategic plan, and the white cards are topics that we came up with at our last board retreat study planning session. And over on the left, Miss Whitney has taken some of our
some of the topics we came up with and bend them over there under different standards, which are on this strategic plan. Let's pass those around. So she says the ones highlighted in green have already been completed. So we've high five, we've made progress since our last planning session.
So Scott, may I just real quick, one of the things I just want to point out is we as a district have a district strategic plan. There were places as a board where we participated in some goal setting. There was some surveying of 10,000 survey respondents. So there was a big stakeholder representation in the strategic plan. These are your current calendars that are up here, these two calendars, one strategic plan, one, these are your standards as a board. And then this is my my transition plan. So what I tried to do is do kind of a crosswalk between the strategic plan. We have kind of three documents, I guess, as a system that we're working on right now. And I just wanted to show kind of visually where those are lining up right now and where they're not. So right now we have one area on the strategic plan that's represented in these other plans. Lots of areas on my transition plan where the board goals are represented and some of the strategic plans are represented. So I just want you to have that context as you continue to plan. I think the more we get stretched across multiple plans, the farther we get away from that targeted specificity you're looking for. So the more we can be aligned kind of across one document and one focus, the extent to which we can do that. But anyways, I had told Stephen Scott that I would do a crosswalk of these three documents, and I wanted to show the outcome of that. So that's this.
So just, is this the point where I get do a little introduction here?
Yep.
So we're all on the same page. Right now, Ms. Whitney is working off of her transition plan. That's what she's working on. We had this retreat in December where we talked about some other ideas and goals, and I believe she's incorporated some of those into her transition plan. What we're trying to do as a board is identify those things that we believe are most critical for our district, that align with our strategic plan, our district strategic plan, that we want her to focus on. Now, right now she's working on her transition plan, and that transition plan goes through June. So that's where her focus is right now. If there's other things that are critical right now, then that we feel like we absolutely have to add to that or start working on right now, then we've got to incorporate that into that transition plan rather than just saying, oh, here's another thing, go do it. But our next segment is going to be from July 1 through December. And then we'll start on an annual evaluation. It goes from January through December. As a board, that's our responsibility, is to do an annual evaluation. And to do that evaluation effectively, we've got to have goals and measures that we're evaluating against. So that's the purpose of this. I think it's going to take more than just this one little meeting here, but ultimately that's where we've got to get to, is where we're setting her objectives for the next year. And so but we've got to get on that schedule right now. Right now she's on the transition plan, then there will be a 6-month period from July through December, and then we'll start our annual. So I would expect today we're probably looking at things that would start in July, and we would do an evaluation in January. They'd go through December, we'd do an evaluation in January. Now that doesn't mean there are things that have to be done in 6 months, but that's the period that we're targeting, whether it's a 6 month or a year and 6 month or a 5-year objective. We want to be able to set checkpoints along the way that we can do an evaluation effectively come December. So now, again, I think if there's things that we feel are critical that we need to start looking at that are important to our stakeholders, our community, and to us right now, then we can start to work those into this transition plan at some point, at whatever level is appropriate. But I think this, we want to stay kind of high level and get some ideas that we can coalesce around that give us direction going forward. Now, I think Ms. Whitney has, the next phase is after the transition plan, is there an entry plan? Is that what it's called? Okay. And there are some specific things that you're trying to accomplish in that entry plan, is that correct? So, and then whatever I think that entry plan has probably got some standard stuff that you'll be doing as a new superintendent. And I would expect that probably becomes part of what our next 6-month evaluation.
Well, the entry plan should be a reflection of continuation of this work.
Right.
So if there's strategic or there's transition plan activities that need to continue and be refined, then those go into the entry plan. It's like, what are you going to accomplish in your first 90 days as superintendent?
Right.
This is what you could expect from you in that first 90 days. In a perfect world, those dots are connected across the existing organizational documents. We're not creating a different document with a different focus outside of the direction that's been given here. It would just be continuation of the direction. So for example, one of the things that are part of our strategic plan that we started is to define a multi-level kind of behavior intervention program. That will be ongoing work that would be, you can see that it got started this January and it would be picked up in July in that entry plan with kind of further, more detailed work. So that's one example of, you know, it's the work here in the transition plan as of July, those things that we need to continue or be refined would be reflected in that entry plan.
Right.
Yeah.
And I would expect, I mean, recognize too that as superintendent, there's always ongoing tasks that are always there. But our job as a board, or goal as a board, should be to set some higher level direction and objectives that give her some direction in what way to go in managing the district. So.
I had a question. Well, I think one of the questions I have in my mind still is with the transition from Ms. Hill. I know she kind of was on leave for a while, so it kind of, you know, things were a little bit up in the air. But kind of the transition, exactly, kind of what are the expectations? You know, what would we like Ms. Hill to do over the next 4 months? As she's transitioning to retirement. I think this is fantastic as far as, you know, what our vision going forward is, but I wasn't sure if there was something there. I just missed that as far as what exactly the expectations are in this 4-month period before Ms. Hill retires.
So we talked about that, and I think what we'll do is next Tuesday, Mr. Christensen and I, during our agenda setting, we'll have a preliminary talk with Ms. Whitney and Ms. Hill on ideas that they have for a workload split, and then Steve and I can talk to them further, and then we'll have an executive session, I would imagine, probably to talk about personnel. Steve and I will talk about it after the agenda setting on how we get additional input from you guys. If you guys have any input, talk to me tonight, maybe, if you have anything that you want to tell me right now. But
I think part of that can come out, again, if there are specific things that we want to see done over the next 4 months, then that probably ought to come out tonight, if it's not, you know, if it's something outside of what we're already doing. So
I still worry about the complexity of this. I mean, that document ties to this document, ties to this document. One thing that I've asked for from the very beginning of the strategic plan is I want measurable outcomes. To me, measurable outcome isn't we implemented this. Measurable outcome is we implemented this behavioral program, and this is the number of incidents that have reduced or increased by this much percent. Basically, this program that we've implemented is working or it isn't working.
Right.
And then let's go from there. And so I almost feel like maybe this session would be good if we discussed outcomes that we want from these goals.
And I'm a little concerned that we don't put these goals under, it's just so complex, it's just hard to get your head around.
So, yeah, you talked about the weeds. So I think what we're going to try to do tonight is keep it at high level type things, put it up here, and then we'll plan a longer 3-4 hour session if we need it on an evening or on a weekend, and we can prioritize what we want to work on, and then we can define these goals at that time.
So what but, are we, I'm confused then, what are we, what information do you want from us this evening?
So let me think, an example, something that you said in the past is you, and I agree with you, I've said the same thing, you want to know how do we use data to evaluate, I don't know what you want to call it, student performance, or if we want to evaluate teaching and learning, but how do you use this data? You can put that up there, and as a high level data is define how standardized test data will be used. It doesn't mean that that's a board priority right now. It's a brainstorm that we'll throw up there, and when we meet in an actual retreat setting for 3 or 4 hours, we can rank all these things and determine which ones we want to pass on as real goals for us, and we can also come up with measurable standards for that at that time. Does that sound?
I think if you go back to this example that Scott used right here. So the CEO will permit no unsafe conditions anywhere within the organization. I mean, that's pretty broad, right? And then it breaks it down. And then the CEO, or in this case, the superintendent, every school site will have an approved safety plan. That isn't direction that's given by the board. The CEO or superintendent would take that information, the high-level goal, and then as superintendent would define, okay, what are we going to do that we can measure this? And then from there it gets broken down even further. And then the report at the end of the year, whatever period, is okay, each school has developed, has cameras, they have staff that are doing this. And then that's the measurable part of it. I don't know that we necessarily need to get into specifying it to that detail. I think our job as a board would be to give some high-level direction.
So does this brain define how standardized test results are used within the district? We take a lot of these tests because we're required by state and federal.
Do you want that as a goal?
No, these aren't goals. These are just brainstorming ideas on questions we have. It could be a high-level policy goal. So you can, if you have a high-level policy type goal or a high-level policy you want to put down, brainstorm that.
Or outcome. I think
an outcome. It can be an outcome.
I agree with Amy that we want some measurable outcomes to show that the progress we made. I think maybe one way is with these different topics and goals, think of an actual outcome that can be measurable that we can attach to some of these higher level goals.
Right? And I think it should be all. If we don't have a way to measure the outcome on a goal, then the goal is largely, to me, it's largely.
So we can do this two ways. We can start with the specific goal and then work it back up to policy, or we can start a policy and work it back down to goal. I think the point today is, all right, what do you want?
So I can give you examples of the direction that the board has already given in terms of how that has worked. So the last time we were together, there was some direction given about simple, attainable, measurable goals or gaudy goals. So that to me was direction the board gave me when we were together last time, and that in February I was supposed to start working on that. So in February, principals interacted with this document to identify some very explicit data that we could collect and monitor that would tell us if we're reaching these goals. So that work's been started, and that was from direction from the board.
Is it more simple, or is it?
We took the Highline document and kind of overlapped it. So then I can report back to the board on that. Another place where I think the board has done a fantastic job giving us very high-level policy direction is around curriculum. You guys came right away out before we even started the curriculum review process with some very specific policies around curriculum. And then we use those policies to build the curriculum review process, and we'll use those policies to develop the processes and protocols we use with our principals and teachers and holding them accountable, et cetera, moving forward. The principals now dove into those policies. They're studying the language and so that they know what the board's expectations are in terms of curriculum moving forward. You guys have wanted to see consistent implementation with fidelity. All of that was built into the policies that you approved. So I think those are two mm-hmm. examples of you guys giving kind of that high level direction and now how that's filtered down into the organization. So if that helps kind of frame.
And all of these goals that are here, I feel like support, you know, specific things that we need, you know, our goals with graduation requirements, our goals are increasing graduation rate, our goals with getting third graders fluent in whatever language that they know. You know, some of those things fit development and implement professional learning around culturally relevant practices. I think that is largely getting wrapped up right now into our curriculum because that's where we professional development right now. So these goals are extremely supportive to those things.
Yeah, I think a lot of the measurable outcomes are affected by a lot of these things. You know, I mean, if your goal is increased graduation requirements or increased literacy by third grade, I mean, those are affected by multiple many of these goals. So, I mean, it's hard to tie to this one goal, but if you know, those are the measurable, you know, high level outcomes that we want, that I mean, we can't specify what percentage this goal contributed to that, but some of those higher level goals or high level outcomes that we want to measure are going to be affected by a lot of these things.
And you know, even with the behavior and the bullying and those issues that we have, you know, if we're not getting into the grassroots and trying to decide how that's measured, I think we need a measurable outcome. And I think it needs to be more than just let's implement this behavior management program. I think we need to figure out if our kids feel safer. And anyway, and you guys can figure that out.
So I want a measurable outcome around kids' feel in terms of student safety.
Mm-hmm.
And it has it somewhere in here where I read it.
Because there was something about, okay, behavior, anyway. I just want a measure, and maybe that's more of a broad thing. I just want measurable outcomes for even what the principals came up with. Data-driven outcomes. Something that we can compare year to year and see either growth or falling so that we can assess if what we're doing is working and we need to continue with it or we need to get rid of it.
So behavior one would be like reported incidents or you know things like that that we can measure at every school.
And something like that can even come into the subjective part because if we do a survey and talk to kids or do a survey and talk to parents and find out, you know, even though it's subjective, when you get that many people, you can get a feel with if our kids and our teachers don't feel and our parents don't feel like school's safe, then whether it's safe or not, we've got to make them feel safe because then they will perform better, they'll mentally whatever. So I think sometimes subjective information like that's still very important, but that's a hard one. Some of these are hard. I just brought that one out, not because I'm, you know, I brought it out because I want these goals to be measurable. I want a graph to tell me where we're going, you know, not, okay, we implemented this, we're doing great, you know. We can implement anything. But if it's not working, then it's useless.
Right. So go ahead and keep brainstorming high level. I'd say I'm interested in seeing how, you know, I talked a second ago about standardized test defined, but I'd like to see the relationship that we have for standardized testing, our new curriculum, and then our Washington State learning standards, and how teachers implement those, because we hear from some people, I spend too much time teaching to the test. I hear from other people, you know,
that my teacher teaches to the test. And then I think our message is we don't teach to the test, right? But what is our message? Do we teach to the Washington State Learning Standards using our new curriculum? Do we teach to our curriculum, and then when it comes close to the test time, we work on tests? I don't know what our message is, but I think we need to talk and have a consistent message on how those three things tie together. Yeah, that's good.
So, and this might be outside of what we're doing, but can we simplify these documents with what you talked to with the principals and put this information, which is excellent information we got from our stakeholders, and put it in specific things so we can have a few specific goals, and then this can be the guiding work. And can we see something like that, so it doesn't look like this? I don't know. It would be fun to test everything against, okay, how does that support this? How does that support these goals that we have for our kids that are simple?
Can we add a little more? So we have that under February, the third one down, we wrote WASA communication and management audit. And as we've talked a little bit more, I think we might be able to break that down into, we were talking about a financial assessment and a communication assessment and an organizational structure assessment. Outside entities. And Ms. Whitney has come up with a new organizational structure that she's going to share. An organizational structure. So she's going to show us a new organizational structure, and we want to make sure that we, whenever we have an audit or an assessment from the outside, that we give them our current structure so that we can get an assessment against that.
I think one of the things that we talked about, Amy's talked about this, and then we had another one of our community members talk about this, is it's consistency across schools. I mean, the two examples are, I think, the bullying or whatever, the discipline, and then the other one was the lady that was talking about band practice or something like that. I don't know what we want to do there, if it's any more than just get information back, but I think we need some kind of consistency, and that probably gets into curriculum too. And so I don't know how to refine that, but just that idea. I think we need to establish some kind of policy so that we have consistency. We've got so many schools now.
And I've been a proponent of consistency, also realizing that our schools are unique entities that have unique needs sometimes. In the sense that even like our STEM elementaries are going to operate more like with those STEM elementary schools, our schools that a large percentage of our kids come in speaking Spanish might look different than our schools that a large percentage of our kids come in speaking English. So I think it's key that we have consistency with our curriculum, our test scores, and some of these things, allowing for some cultural differences, not culture like, anyway, culture, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's the same with curriculum. I mean, we want to allow some autonomy, but we've got to have some consistency too.
Yes.
And so what that balance is, I don't know, but I think that's something that we need to look at.
And I think we need to go more toward consistency, because right now I think we're not consistent
enough. I mean, looking at some recent issues that have people in the community upset, if we look at consistency, and we've already brought up addressing bullying safety issues. That shouldn't matter what school you go to. You should just feel safe. People should, you know, students should be dealt with somewhat equally and appropriately and consistently. So from school to school, we can have confidence that everything is being addressed and that each school is safe. Some of these other programs that we've talked about or that have been coming up that maybe don't have as much to do with the learning, but, you know, the music, I think you guys wrote music, these other programs, you know, there's, the schools may have different approaches, but there needs to be some consistency in what's available, because in our age now with technology, people can easily check, you know, if they're told at one school, this isn't how we do it in the district, and then they just get on Facebook or talk to their friend and go, well, my friend next door at this school does it that way. And so that's very frustrating as a parent or a student to have that inconsistency, you know, when you're told that, well, that's not how we do it in the district, but then you easily can find that it's not that way at other schools. Or
so good luck with that.
Yeah, good luck with that. Or holidays is another one that's come up again. You know, like it, some schools celebrate holidays and others don't. You know, all these types of things where, you know, our principals in general seem to have a lot of saying what happens at each school. You know, what level of consistency do we want from school to school, and how much variation do we want that you're getting a different experience if you move to a different school?
You know, this last summer, I really struggled with the fact that we knew that there was a good chance the legislature would get rid of the biology exam. And as a board, because our policy says that everyone has to meet graduation requirements, these kids that had already met the previous year's graduation requirements currently could not graduate. And there was this thing that there was a good chance that they were going to graduate anyway because legislature was about to drop that requirement for that year. And it looked like they were going that way. But because our board policy said, you know, we don't allow these kids to graduate, we didn't allow them to. I worry our policy gets so strict that, like, in that situation, we can't. I don't know. We can't be a little bit more, I don't know. And so I struggle with some of those policies that sometimes don't address individual needs or extenuating circumstances.
So that's, if we don't think the policy is right, then that's our job to change the policy. But if it's on an individual basis, that's why we have the ability to have individual hearings, like we did have some individual hearings on that, those issues. So we can do one or two things. If you think that the policy needs to be changed, bring it to all of us and we can talk about it. Or if you're good with the policy in general, but just not for individual circumstances, then that's when people have the right to bring their concern to the board for their individual circumstances.
In that situation, I felt like our policy said this, and we felt like we needed to uphold that policy. The problem was, is it was an extenuating circumstance, and just as we had all felt like might happen, that was dropped, and all of those kids that could not participate that whole week in graduation, which there was, I believe, 13 in our district, 16 in our district, what was it? There were 6 in Chihuahua alone. Anyway, there were several in our district that weren't able to participate in that because I shouldn't say legislatures. Anyway, because of some of the fickle parts of legislators and their ups and downs and let's do this and that might not be the wisest thing that our kids suffer. So, I don't know. I just worry about our policy becoming so rigid that these extenuating circumstances affect kids' lives negatively.
So one other one that I'm not real clear on, and it might have to do with one we've already put up there, is standards-based grading and the whole grading system. I think this last conference we went to, this legislative conference, somebody was talking about grade inflation, and it may have been in another meeting that I was in separately, but are we consistent in grading across the district? That I think that's something that we... If we don't need to look at, I would certainly like to understand a little better.
How do you do that when grading is such a subjective thing?
I think that's why we have standards. And one of the things that people talked about, and maybe this was in a general session, but they talked about just, you know, kids just showing up for class and okay, you're here, you pass. not really understanding the information, and I don't know what the answer is. But
Carson.
So kind of going off this, we actually, at Pasco High School, I know our science department actually has a separate grading practice for the subject of science, and then it's different than all other subjects. So I don't know, maybe creating something that's more consistent in the science department as well, because they use a numerical system. The other subjects use A, B, C, and that.
The ESPAC was supposed to create formative assessments, and those were supposed to come out. Have those come out yet? So there are formative assessments for each level. Is that something that we consistently administrate in ours? Because that would be a really easy way to see where every school is across the district if they're all taking those things, that those ESPAC assessments.
Yeah, we're not consistently implementing at this point, but it's certainly the goal. And again, I think we hold all our hopes on this curriculum process, but that's part of the, when you develop a curricular guide, as part of the curriculum process, you identify assessments or benchmark assessments, and they may be an ESPAC, you know, developed, or it could be a different tool, but that's part of that process, is to get a consistent framework for all kids' instructional experiences like this, and all kids will at least have these three or four benchmark assessments that are consistent.
So maybe that should be one of our goals, having common formative assessments across the school district. It's already out there.
Well, that's not up there, but it's part of the curriculum.
We don't want to add assessments, I don't think. I mean, I think we have plenty of assessments. I think the legislature and state and national, I mean, I think they meant well, I want to say, with these. And of course, because they're trying to establish a standard, right? If you got a B in biology, you should know there's some core that we should be able to compare from class to class, school to school. And I think we struggle with grade inflation. I think that's an issue in colleges. It has been for years in high schools, if you look just at what people's GPAs were. And I think the idea is that if you take AP Calculus at Pasco High and you transfer to Hanford High, you should have the same general knowledge and general teaching, and that should be somewhat consistent. And so not just from our schools to Pasco, to Chiawana, New Horizons, whatever, but to other school districts, I mean, there should be some consistency. The problem is when you have each teacher grading, I mean, there's gonna be some variation, and a lot of that's subjective, but I think their idea was to establish some standards so that if Carson took AP Calculus and, say, got an A, that actually means something. And if he went to Hanford or Kennewick or Kamaikin, and we could actually, that would be comparable to some degree. And I think it's not right now necessary. And I don't mean just in our district, but maybe in everywhere. Maybe it doesn't mean anything. We don't really know what knowledge did you earn, what work did you do, compared to these other schools, because it probably wasn't equivalent from school.
And that's where the Washington State Learning Standards tie in, I think, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
if
you have mastered all of those standards, I would think that'd be an A.
Yeah.
And so we would have to implement that consistently across the district, that if I'm gonna give an A, it means that they've mastered these standards. And every district would have to do that in order for the ideal to work.
In the end, the execution was poor, obviously, implementing tests that had not been validated and immediately required, you know, all the students to pass this biology test or this, and without validating it, and just with no exceptions, really. It was very poorly carried out, but I mean, I think they're right. That was their idea, was to have it actually mean something. When we say, you graduate, we can, you know, you actually did a certain amount of things.
Well, I say we got to put a lot of that on ourselves to consistently implement these things through policies, or if they're not policy level decisions, through procedures and through fidelity and implementation. So.
And Aaron, common formative assessments aren't adding assessments. They are chapter end assessments. They are what teachers use to see if what they have taught in a certain unit is learned. So it's something that teachers, that we've all, it's not like an addition. But what's nice about doing common formative rather than whatever the teacher decides to use to decide if they've learned, it's taking those assessments, those chapter tests, and making sure they're going clear across the district. That way, if you get into a group and there's eight teachers that are all second grade, you can pull out that assessment and say, look at, my kids are here, your kids are there, your kids are there, you're excellent at teaching this. You know, maybe I'm not as good at teaching it or this certain thing. What are you doing differently? It just is a huge tool to help kids get up to the same level, simply using chapter tests. I mean, that's basically what they are. But if everyone has their own different chapter test, it's hard to know if the kids are where they're supposed to be at a certain level.
Yeah, and I think that's the idea with the curriculum, right? That people are kind of using the same the same thing to assess.
Same curriculum and same assessments that we can compare, you know? It would be nice, even as a board sometimes, to see, okay, where are these different schools in these different assessments occasionally? Even though it's just a basic level assessment, I think it keeps the work going, and we can see that they're being used.
And a lot of the guidance that, like what you just talked about, is in the new policy, right? So there's some language around course design and what does that mean, and making sure that when there's a new course that's going to be developed and offered, that there's a process through the curriculum PD department where you're delineated across the district so that Spanish, when it's offered for high school credit in eighth grade, is the same level of class that you're getting at high school, et cetera, and all of that is in the policies that you provided for us. So there's a lot of great guidance for us in terms of how to continue that curricular work.
So we haven't talked about it a lot lately because we've been, I think, kind of waiting to see about the results from tonight's levy election, but let's put a bond and facilities task force path forward.
When are we going to determine what's going to be on that bond?
I believe we've scheduled a study session for the 23rd for that, to start those conversations. Mm-hmm. Well, not about that, but about property or capital projects, priorities, and then, you know, that's a precursor to then having that conversation. So you'd be expecting as a board to have start that planning process.
So we probably should all, on our own, refresh on what that facilities task force recommendation looked like. I don't remember if we had that before Dr. Richardson joined the board or right after.
No. Yeah.
Okay.
How about when was that? 2000.
Well, no. The facilities task force met this last year, and then they gave us a presentation in October, I believe.
And I'll review that.
Sarah said it's online, so okay. If you need some help.
So there's another point I have to make.
I don't want to get into that one.
I know. Just want. I've been to lots of different district websites, and I want our website to be a little more navigable. There's some really good parts of it. It's really easy to get to the elementary schools and the high schools and their own individual websites. But sometimes it's just hard to navigate when I need a teacher's email as a parent using these things. And as a school board member, knowing it's on there somewhere and spending 35 minutes to find it, and I don't think any one of us is a professional at it. So I don't know if we need to hire somebody to help us with questions and answers and communication and really simplifying that.
We've talked about this a lot. We can just throw it up there. Improve website organization and content, I think.
Website organization and content, and then the communications that happen on that website. But maybe that's a separate thing. So, yeah.
Is it up
there? Is that a grassroots?
Let's just put it up there.
I said I put increased navigation PSD website. Don't you put something else?
Navigation and content, I think we can.
Sure. Well, I can get up.
With that being that, we can look at what other districts have, important, not we as a board, but I think the district can look at what other districts have around the state and increase the content we have and the ease of use of that website.
And I think the district needs to, we need a person who is in charge of that, that has skills that they can do that, instead of you go do that and we don't know. Do we have someone in district that is a webmaster?
We have people on the website. I don't know if they're deemed a webmaster. I would need to look into exactly what.
Well, I created the website. It's pretty sorry. I mean,
well, it took me hours to get the transition plan on the website,
So what I'm saying is I'm not qualified.
Neither am I.
I am looking at hiring someone for our personal business because ours is lousy. So I just wonder if, I just want to make sure we get what we need to in that, because I think that's crucial because it's the face of the district.
So, and I think Scott talked about this, an audit of our communications in general. And I think there's things that we need to do to improve communications. The website is one part of communications.
Yes.
We've got Facebook, which is web-based, is another part of communications, but written communications, and I think the website and Facebook are critical at this point. The people, I mean, that website, you have to be able to update that thing that quick, whether it all goes through one person or everybody has the ability to go in and change it, which seems a little scary, but.
And we have some opportunities to do that. There's a couple positions that are open in the communications department and have been, and that's part
right.
of, you know, where
right.
we're at is.
Right.
So we have some opportunity moving forward.
That's positive.
I think to structure that department so that it's efficient and effective is
Unless
critical.
Unless he's been thoughtful and, you know, thinking about how do we do that moving forward. So.
Unless we appreciate the work that you've done. I don't want to be critical of the work of the district.
I
feel like sometimes we go outside of our expertise and then it makes it hard to do anything.
No, I think Leslie's been working short staffed, so
yes,
makes it difficult.
For over
yeah.
a year. Well, yeah. hopefully we can change that.
And I think, Michelle, you talked about working on the organizational structure, getting that. And that's
yeah.
one of the things that we talked about, getting that, I don't know what the right word is, but at least having it so people know what people, so that people know what people are doing in the district office, because that's one of the things that some people have been very vocal about.
We've talked about documenting like roles and responsibilities for everyone,
right.
For every position that's on there, and I think you're working towards that. We've at least had the conversation.
Yeah, and I think that's something that...
And even going beyond just knowing what people are doing, but talking about the way in which we do our work is a service orientation.
Right.
So, you know, we've started that work and we had our first kind of planning of a module that will go back into the departments around, you know, what we expect as some core values when we communicate. So it's not only knowing what people do and what are the essential functions of each position, but an expectation that we're of service and what does that look like throughout the organization. You know, my hope and goal and my dreams a year from now that concept is institutionalized at least at the district level.
We can add to that when we can say we're defining roles and responsibilities. Is that? Do you have anything you wanted to add, Carson?
No,
student perspective.
Yeah, we're looking into that right now. Student representatives, we're working together here to create a report possibly for the board to see student perspective on topics currently the board is considering.
So as we were driving up to the ledge session, we were talking about study sessions, and these guys volunteered to put one together with student concerns, and you guys are going to interview classmates and other
Yeah, we were thinking about doing something like forums that we have with the students during possibly lunchtime and all that, meeting with schools, ASBs, and also coordinating with New Horizons High School and their ASB group that they have there. Really getting the student perspective, not only from us three, but from the entire district.
Awesome.
So another thing I want to throw out is, and I don't know how to frame this, but I think, in my mind, one of the most critical components of a successful school is a successful principal. And I know that, I mean, we've got TPEP, right? Teacher and principal evaluation, whatever it is. How effectively is that being implemented? And are all of our principals top performers?
Meaning? The excellent in this career, or meaning?
Yes.
Okay.
And if not, I don't know whether it's excellent, superior.
Good and superior. Proficient.
No, we just want top performers, because that's critical.
What is it? Distinguished. Proficient, distinguished. Okay.
So you can follow whatever label you want. I don't know that necessarily distinguished means that they're an excellent principal. But I think we need top performing principals, whatever that means.
On average. I mean,
yeah,
average.
That's something I think we'd have to discuss, and I know that's a sensitive thing, but I think that's critical that we have top-performing principals in every school, and not just in one area, but well-rounded top-performing principals.
You know, if we have things more outcome-based, I think that it'll be more obvious. I don't know if the data's perfect, comes out. I think it'll be easier to see. A lot of times, if you have a principal that's not, or their school's not functioning at the level that it should be, they just need more training, or need help implementing this or that, or how to structure it. And so that's kind of where the TPEP is laid out, because it gives a lot of room for improvement. And so getting our principals up to that distinguished and proficient.
Teachers the same thing.
And teachers are the same thing, yeah.
And it just making sure that we have top quality people, but I think especially a principal, they're kind of the face of the school, and they're interfacing with the students and parents, and they're interfacing and managing those teachers. I just think it's critical that we have top performing people. Now maybe there's a system in place to make sure all that happens and it's all running smoothly, and I'm just not that informed. But
I just want to make a comment on what Carson said before I forget. With the student forums and the student representatives, I think that's a great idea to kind of gather that buy-in and input from students. And just mentioned, I'm not sure what time the students apply for board positions. Is that coming up? But I think we really need to look at having a New Horizons student on the board. New Horizons students are all Pasco students, and Delta, we're only a third of the students at Delta. So I think if we have a Delta student on the board, New Horizons deserves just as much, if not more, to have a student on the board, since that's all Pasco students. So I'd like to see that.
It might be worth revisiting that.
I'd like to see us revisit that at the before we move forward with student board representatives for next year.
So over in Olympia this last weekend was, I don't remember which school district it was, but they had student committees, and they had 6 or 8 students from each high school with them. And Carson is our board rep, and Carson is the face of Pasco High School. He's one student representing 2,500. And it might be good to have a committee of sorts and then decide from there what we do. But anyway, certainly something worth looking at.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Oh, okay. Well, something to visit with that, if we do end up doing a committee like that, I'm just making sure that students are well versed on what's actually going on before sending them into these things.
Yes.
There were students that maybe didn't know exactly what was going on.
Yes.
And I think that's something, with this position on the board, I've learned a lot in my time. So I think sharing that with the students, if we were to bring more to these conferences, is crucial for that.
So I think this is a discussion worth having. I think it's been great for you, and it's been great for all of our student reps, from an exposure to lots of different things. I think the real question, though, is are we getting value? Is your input getting to us, or is it just a great experience for you? And how can we make that broader rather than just 3 students, or 4 if we have one from New Horizons? How do we make that broader so that we reach more? Anyway, the discussion to have on that subject.
I mean, I think what you're talking about doing is great. That's a good starting point, right? That, you know, get have your little meetings and assess input. If there's a lot of desire to have more students involved in some way and they're interested in that, I think that's a great opportunity. One of the things that I like as a big level goal is, as you know, Amy had talked about measurable outcomes, I try to think, what are some simple, you know, high level goals in general that we want as for our school district? You know, you think about, everyone talks about graduation rates, third grade literacy. We've talked about increasing our student safety. Another thing I thought about as a high level goal would be students graduating with their AA or other certification. One of the things I took from the New Horizons meetings and with this involvement with CBC is that they have a lot to offer our students in terms of what types of certification, things that they're interested in, they can graduate with that. I also met with Mr. Sital a couple weeks ago at Pasco High, and he said that they really have a goal of that at Pasco, to really offer the students some certifications that if they're interested in, you know, these different Microsoft certifications or other things that add value to their education, that they can graduate with some employability and some skills. I think that's something we really need to look into increasing as an overall measurable outcome that adds a lot of value to what our students are getting from their education. So this type of thing, where the number of students involved in legislative type issues may be something, there may be, obviously this has been very beneficial to you as a student. Is there a way to expand that to more students that they gain that type of experience?
Absolutely, yeah. I work with our ASB as well. And we do conversations during ASB meetings about topics within the school. Yeah,
and you know, with that certification, not all kids, I mean, I think it's good to track that and include that, but I wonder if there's a way to wrap that with maybe kids that are getting college credit, or kids that are graduating college credit. But in that, I think an overall goal isn't just graduating from high school, it's being prepared for secondary education. I would love to see our kids have as many choices as possible. Whether they want to go into the technical field or whether they want to go to college, that they graduate capable of doing those things. And so a certification helps, college credit that you already have proves that kids can already, you know, function at a college level. So there's lots of ways you can measure having kids college and technical school ready.
I think Dr. Cummins is a great resource for us as we're increasing our involvement with CBC for our students and our community to increase those services where we're helping with dual credit, these certificates, these, you know, getting an A, whatever it is. You know, one thing that when I meet with students at work or youth, it's like, what's your passion? Discover your passion. Let's help you get there and reach that. And maybe it's probably not a four-year. It's definitely not a four-year college for all students. Whatever their interest or passion lies, we want to help them get there, and that's how they will be happy and successful in life, and that's going to be different for different students.
All right. Any other comments?
Yeah. You know, and one thing too with our having, I think revisiting that might be really good. Have they ever thought about having the student, if we did four, could we just have two come every once a month rather than twice a month? I know this is really hard with some of the schedules. Anyway, we could look into that.
Yeah.
If we're going to expand four.
All right, so 6 o'clock, I guess we'll close this up, and I think we had good discussion. It's not very often that we get to just have an open forum between us as board members. We usually have something very focused scheduled to talk about, but we'll continue to do this. I think we'll have Ms. Whitney take this and organize it for us, and then Steve and I'll look at that and determine what type of format we want to have next for funneling this down, making it more focused, and then once we get it focused, we can dive into the details on what kind of measurable goals we want, what kind of issues here, our policy level type leadership, and which one of them is our procedures, and how we implement the stuff that we wrote up here. All right, so we'll have a break until 6:30 when we start a board meeting.